Foreign direct investment in India is booming. In 2020, net inflows of foreign direct investment was at $73 billion, or roughly 2.6% of GDP, and it is set to be about $82 billion in 2021, which will be about 2.7% of GDP. So, I had a question. Does foreign direct investment actually matter? Is increasing FDI a good thing for a country? First of all, let's talk about the issues that India used to and still faces with FDI. Now, let me be quite frank. These are not my opinions, rather educated opinions and facts from research papers, podcasts, etc. from credible sources. If you want to go in depth into the topic as I have done, I have cited the research papers I have read. Just copy paste the citation into Google and the research paper shows up. So, let's talk about some things that India has going good for it that make it an attractive destination for FDI. First of all, its size. In economics, size matters. India has a huge domestic market. Compared to its neighbors, its rule of law with respect to corporate law is more favorable, although this point is open to debate. And it is a well-functioning democracy. Now, about this point, you may argue that a non-democracy still are pretty good at attracting FDI. Case in point, China. But I think the main point here is having stability in your political regime. So basically, you don't want to be flip-flopping like Myanmar. Now, what are the challenges India faces? Well, there are a lot. First of all, there is a restrictive FDI regime, or at least there was. Now, you may argue, and I shall argue, that FDI is not always a good thing for a developing country. But there is nothing wrong with saying that a restrictive FDI regime reduces FDI. The second point is India's high import tariffs. India, still to this day, has one of the highest import tariffs. Now, 1 or 2 months ago, I would have said that this was a major problem for India's development. But I have sort of changed my mind, and that was when I was confronted with a historical fact. And that is that developed countries, when they were developing, had huge import tariffs. And these same countries are now arguing for the reduction of import tariffs in developing countries. Now, maybe we can say that correlation is not causation, and that the import tariffs that developed countries implemented were hindering their economic development, or we could even say that the economic regimes that were in place during the times when the Western world was developing encouraged and favored import tariffs. And today, this is not the case. In today's world, with changes in the exchange rate regimes or the attitudes of developed countries, it would actually be beneficial for developing countries to reduce import tariffs simply because it would put them in a more favorable light when it comes to trading with developed countries. Now, I shall make another video going more in depth into the argument for domestic protectionism and whether it is good or bad for developing countries. So do subscribe if you want to see that when it comes out. Now, there is one point that nobody can argue with, and if they do, they are wrong. And that is that foreign direct investment is the creme de la creme of capital flows. You do not want short-term lending in your economy, especially if you are a developing country with low foreign reserves who needs to import in dollars. And guess what? India in 1991 was exactly that. And this was a big factor that caused the 1991 crisis. I have a video on that, by the way. Check it out if you want. Alright, let's talk about something very important. India's infrastructure was absolute garbage, and it still today is bad. But it has gone drastic changes in the last few years. Now, let's talk about something which I like to call the marginal benefit of infrastructure. Infrastructure is an amazing investment for developing countries, but they don't have the cash to pay for it. Why is it an amazing investment? Because the marginal benefit of infrastructure for them is crazy high. Think of it. Imagine the railroad system in the US. At first, building railways in the 18th to 19th century was an amazing investment because it linked the West Coast to the East Coast and there was huge demand for that. But then investors went crazy and just built railway on railway, and the marginal benefit of infrastructure tanked. Now, this same logic can be used in the case of developing countries. India building basic road infrastructure, water, sewage, and all other kinds of good stuff is going to dramatically reduce transportation costs for India. And India is in a pretty good situation to raise funds, especially now, for building this infrastructure. Monetary sovereignty is key to public debt. The more control you have over your money, the more debt you can get into. Other factors such as aging, foreign capital, business cycles also play a role, but this is a good rule to follow. This rule is also one of the reasons India's managed float is not a good idea. Anyways, you can use this debt to stimulate your economy during recessions. And guess what? For developing countries, infrastructure is an excellent investment. I want to introduce you to a public policy called MNREGA. Basically, it is a job guarantee program for extremely poor people. It provides them with some guaranteed days of work, and the government can use this labor during recessions to build all kinds of infrastructure. There are certain problems with the quality of labor, but that's besides the point. So, a combination of increased monetary sovereignty, very high marginal benefit of infrastructure, counter-cyclical fiscal policy, and a focus on infrastructure can really help you get FDI. Now, a while back, almost a month ago, I attended an event hosted by LSE Events called the Global Infrastructure Gap, and Dr. Peter Blair Henry, who was the guest of the event, talked about how big banks in the US and the developed world have basically run out of good investments in the manufacturing and production sector and are beginning to look at the infrastructure gap as a sort of way to make money and do some good. So, JP Morgan had launched the Development Finance Institution, and this was sort of before the pandemic, and they wanted to pump hundreds of billions into the developing world to close the infrastructure gap. The US Treasury estimated it would take $875 billion a year to close this gap. You can check out the recording of that event. I shall put the link for the YouTube video of that in the description. But basically, there are 20 to 40 countries which have infrastructure investments like road, electricity, and other stuff, which are actually profitable for banks and investors and are also socially beneficial. Now, there is a problem of it being very easy to invest in infrastructure that doesn't actually produce productivity gains. But this situation doesn't really apply much to India. This is more of a situation in sub-Saharan Africa. But basically, now that banks have run out of other kinds of investments, they're beginning to look at infrastructure investments. And with the changing atmosphere for FDI in India, India has and will be a big benefactor of these kinds of investments. Now, one thing I would like to highlight is that there's a lot of competition between states for FDI, and this competition is a good thing. So, basically, back in the early 2000s, South India was really the place to invest for foreign direct investors, mainly because the FDI regimes were much more friendly there, and Bihar and Uttar Pradesh were really at the bottom of the pile. Now, if you don't know, Bihar is the poorest state in India, and Uttar Pradesh is the most populous state, and both of them were some of the poorest states in India. But in recent years, especially the late 2010s, Bihar has been consistently one of the fastest growing states in India. Much of this is because it started at a really low level, but still, these numbers are nothing to scoff at. Uttar Pradesh has done really good in attracting FDI, especially during the pandemic. And this sort of competition between states is a good thing in the short run because it speeds up the reform process as the fastest reforms get the most investment. Now, a lot of people want India to pursue the export-led growth model. And while this model has been extremely good for China and a few other countries, I have begun to grow skeptical about it. Basically, the theory behind the export-led growth model is based on Ricardo's comparative advantage theory, where he says that countries should produce what they are good at and import the rest. What this does is that by specializing in what you are good at, international trade can increase the size of the global pie. Basically, if you can produce something at cheaper, then you should produce that and stop trying to produce everything. But the problem with this is that some argue that this has been taken too far and that this is causing developing countries to stay poor. Now, I would like to quote Dr. Stephanie Kelton, an MMT economist, on why she thinks that export-led growth is a bad idea. Quote, international Western elites have told poorer countries they should not indulge in development strategies that focus on job creation, energy dependence, or any goals aside from specialized production. In effect, it is a recommendation that keeps developing countries forever developing, never achieving the kind of advanced, diversified economies of the modern West. That recommendation is the opposite of the historical path taken by the United States, Japan, and most other crucial economies. Unquote. She goes on to say that China has also developed significantly simply by increasing internal trade, just like the US had done decades ago. Although, to me, this did seem a bit misleading because China was able to boost its international trade only due to an increase in aggregate demand in the coastal areas fueled by export-led growth. Now, regardless of what my views are on MMT or what your views are on MMT, what Dr. Stephanie Kelton has to say on international trade does have some truth. Simply, export-led growth is not a good strategy for long-term development. Countries need to build up regional industries even in sectors where they may not have comparative advantage. Now let us move on to foreign direct investment and how it affects economic growth. Foreign direct investment is like a transfer of technology. Multinational corporations have extremely advanced technologies of production, business management, and all kinds of other stuff. Now, logic would dictate that by MNCs setting up shop in developing countries, the technology brought into the economy is bound to reduce prices, increase efficiency, and lower costs, and overall make the economy better for consumers. And this is true, but there is one big caveat, and that is that there is a minimum threshold of human capital stock that is required for FDI to have any positive effect on productivity. In 1997, three researchers decided they wanted to analyze the effect of FDI on economic growth. And using econometric tools and controlling for a wide range of factors like initial income, human capital, government consumption, and parallel market premium for foreign exchanges, they were able to come to the conclusion that FDI alone does not cause economic growth. But if we were to measure for FDI multiplied by human capital, which they measured using years of secondary schooling for males, because during that time this was the best indicator that correlated with human capital and economic growth. So basically, by replacing FDI in their models with FDI times human capital, they found a strong correlation between FDI and economic growth with a human capital threshold, below which FDI did not cause economic growth. Now, you may ask, what does this all mean in the case of India? Well, this research paper was made in 1997, when the best measure for human capital was secondary male schooling, and it still may be when this comes to correlation with economic growth. However, for simple intuition, I think we could use the human capital index to see comparatively the advantage of FDI across countries. Of course, this is all roughly. Again, if you have a better data set that you would like to use, feel free to put it in the comments. Another point to note with the human capital index is that I don't really know how to derive a threshold beyond which FDI is advantageous. So maybe in later videos, once I have learnt a bit more in econometrics, I could do that. Anyways, back to the index. India has an HCI of 0.49. Let's compare this to our neighbors. China has an HCI of 0.65. Pakistan has an HCI of 0.41. Or Bangladesh with an HCI of 0.46. If you want to look at the high end, we have Singapore with 0.88. And on the low end, we have a lot of sub-Saharan countries with HCIs in the range of 0.25 and 0.3. Now, this gives us a rough understanding of the index. Based on my intuition, if I were to graph the HCI index on the x-axis and effectiveness of FDI on economic growth on the y-axis, then I think we would sort of get an S-shaped curve, meaning that those countries with an HCI of 0.25 to 0.3 do not get any benefit from FDI. And as the country moves from 0.3 to 0.5 to 0.6, the effectiveness of FDI on economic growth rapidly rises. and then the effectiveness sort of plateaus at 0.7 to 0.8. Now, the top end of the graph stuff might get a bit fussy because for countries with such a high level of HCI, other factors come into play that affect FDI. Alright, I have begun to notice that this video is a bit long, so I shall sum up the last two points quickly. Does FDI crowd out domestic investment? That is, does FDI compete for limited investment slots with domestic investment? According to the paper I read, this is not the case. In fact, FDI actually crowds in investment. This is, for every $1 of FDI, total investment increases by about $1.5 to $2.3. Again, this data may have changed with the times, but I think the point still holds. Now, the second and last point is FDI more efficient than domestic investment? And the answer is yes. This is because FDI usually flows into more technologically advanced sectors. This may also be why there is a human capital threshold. Whereas domestic investment could be going into more traditional industries, basically less advanced industries like low-scale agriculture. Alright, that is a wrap. If you guys have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments. If you disagree with anything again, leave it in the comments and I shall respond. Honestly, I really enjoyed researching for this video since it was a bit longer and I did dive a bit deeper into the empirical aspects of this question. All of the research papers I read are cited down below. There are some caveats to the finding of these research papers which are in the research papers, which you may find interesting if you go check them out. And I shall see you next time.